Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. Have you and your partner settled on your top three questions for investigating the Ogeechee River fish kill? Let's go back to our classroom to see how your questions compare to those of some other students who came up with questions of their own.
Okay, let's hear some of the ideas you and your partner came up with. Logan.
Okay, our top three questions are, did the fish die because of a chemical pollution? Did the fish die due to excessive heat? And was there a drought that prevented the animals from getting enough water?
Good job. How about back there?
We also had the same question about chemical pollution, and we also came up with these two. Did the fish have some kind of disease that killed them? And was there a predatory invader that killed the fish?
But to be honest, we don't know if the second option is as likely since so many fish were killed in such a small area.
Good job, that's well thought out. For now, we want to ask all the questions we can, so it's good to put down anything you think could be a possibility. And now I can give you a bit more information too. In 2011, the King Finishing Company was located near the area of the fish kill. They manufactured flame retardant textiles and used a lot of chemicals on their products to reduce flammability. Now, with all of that in mind, what do you all think is the most likely cause of the fish kill?
Maybe it was because of some kind of chemical pollution.
Okay. Of course, the fact that we're sitting in a chemistry classroom is probably a pretty big hint too. In any case, for the second part of our science practice, we need to formally define the problem. And the more concise and specific, the better. What do you think? Go ahead, Keisha.
How about in May of 2011, many fish died on the Ogeechee River as a result of chemical spill?
Great, nice work.
Now that we've asked a lot of questions and clearly defined the problem, it's time to move on to our second science and engineering practice, generating a hypothesis and developing a model. In science, a hypothesis refers to a testable idea. A statement that's not testable would not be science. Science can only be used on testable hypotheses. A hypothesis is a tentative explanation that can lead to a prediction, and a hypothesis can be tested by further investigation. Unlike our questions from the first practice, it should be in the form of a statement. Of course, not every investigation requires a hypothesis. In fact, over time, a lot of scientific discoveries have come out of investigations into the unknown, so formal hypotheses could not be formed. But we'll develop one here because we have some reliable background information. A good hypothesis does three things for the scientist. First, it attempts to explain an observation. An observation is any information gathered using any of your five senses and sometimes with the help of lab instruments. As we already said, a good hypothesis must be testable. This testing can be performed in many ways, in or outside of a laboratory setting. Finally, a good hypothesis will predict the outcome of an experiment. Hypotheses are often rejected when the outcome of an experiment is different from what it predicts. But that's okay, because scientists can learn something from the test, no matter what the results are. After a hypothesis is formed, the next step is usually developing a model to test it. In science, a model is a physical, conceptual, or mathematical representation of a real phenomenon whose purpose is to explain and predict what happens in real life. So models are basically reasoning tools, and they're usually more complex than hypotheses. The word model can mean a lot of different things. There can be physical models, or a model could be a computer simulation, or even an equation. Sometimes a model of an airplane or car can be built, showing how the vehicle might look or move, in smaller scale, of course. A model home might be a full-size house that people can walk through to see what other houses in a new neighborhood might look like. A fashion model might wear designer clothing so that people can see what the clothes look like. So let's get back to the classroom, where students are developing a hypothesis, which will lead us to a model for testing.
You all said you think a chemical is the most likely cause of the fish kill. What are some of the ways a chemical could have gotten into the river? Sam.
I think the finishing company could have spilled some kind of acid into the river.
Or it could have been a fertilizer from a nearby farm. My uncle's a farmer, and he says that fertilizers are bases.
Acid rain is a possibility.
Good. Anything else? Keisha.
Maybe the fish died because water evaporated and the chemicals in the water, like an acid, became more concentrated.
Okay. All of these are testable ideas because we can check the river to see if there's an acid or a base in the water. Then we could even examine the fish to see if there's any acid or base damage to their bodies. So let's get started on developing our hypothesis.
And this is a good place to once again take a break from our video so you can do a little more of this science practice of developing a hypothesis. Remember that in science practice number one, you asked questions, but a hypothesis has to be in the form of a statement. First, work alone and write down the hypothesis you'd like to test to learn what might have happened to the fish. Then discuss it with a partner to create the best hypothesis possible. When you're done, we'll see you at the top of the next video.